So here's a simple question for you to answer. So let's say we have a rear wheel drive car, which means that the rear wheels are being now powered. There is a torque applied on them. And this is point A, this is point B, right? And let's say there is friction between the rear wheel and the ground, and there's no friction between the front wheels and the ground. Maybe you're driving this car and you get stuck in mud, your front wheels are in the mud, and you know, there's not that much friction available to you, but your rear wheels still have the friction. So now, if you power the car, if you apply the torque on the rear wheels, how would the car move? Is it going to move, first of all? Well, if you draw the free body diagram of the car without the ground, then you will have friction force FA pointing in the forward direction. And that means that the car is going to move forward, right? Because there is some friction amount, friction force available to you. There's no friction on the front wheel, which means that there's nothing to make the wheels rotate, right? The front wheels rotate. So the car is going to move in that case, but the way it will move is the front wheels will not change their orientation. So if you have this line, you know, after a while, this line would be maintained. So which means that the front wheels would be essentially just translating while the rear wheels would be rolling without slipping. Okay, let's do another example. This is an old example, 8.3. Work energy principle and rolling without slip. So we have a rear wheel drive car. That accelerates from rest to a final speed Vf over a distance L along a horizontal stretch. So velocity is changing from 0 to Vf over a distance L. The front wheels do not slip, so which means there is friction between the front wheels and the rear wheels. And we neglect rolling resistance. So remember, rolling resistance is usually responsible for the loss in energy. We are neglecting that over here. We are also neglecting bearing friction and the air drag. If the geometric center of each wheel is also the wheel's mass center G, so the geometry center and the wheel's mass center are same. Determine those forces on each front wheels that do work and express that work in terms of the given speed Vf, the wheel's radius R, mass Mw, and mass moment of inertia. The second question is, can this expression for work be used to find the average friction force acting on the wheel? So the question is for the front wheel. So let's draw a free body diagonal of the front wheel. So we have the center of mass. Let's say this point is Q. That's the normal reaction. Then front wheels, this is a rear wheel drive car, which means that the friction force on the front wheel is going to be acting in that way. Okay, and then we have the weight, MWG. You will also have some forces coming from the frame of the car where the axle is attached to the wheel, right? So we have V and H. And there's no torque applied on the front wheel, because this is a rear wheel drive car, right? So let's show our quadrant system. Okay, so how do we proceed? Well, we have a method. Let's apply that method. We have to do as much kinematic analysis as we can, right? And assuming that the wheel is rolling without slipping, then we know the velocity of this V0. So we will not call it V0, we'll just call it V, because V0 might indicate its initial velocity, is equal to the radius times omega that we have from the kinematic analysis. Then free body diagram is just drawn. We have to identify the forces that do any work. So MWG will not do any work, because MWG is always pointing in the direction perpendicular displacement, which is horizontal. N will not do any work. Okay, we have just seen that the friction force F will not do any work either, because the contact point has zero velocity, right? So friction force F in this case is not doing any work either. Now remember, rolling resistance, which is also present most of the time because of the deformation of the tires as well as the ground and the hysteresis losses, there will be some losses due to rolling resistance, but that is something we are neglecting in this case. V will not do any work, because also pointing in the direction perpendicular to the displacement. So the only force that is going to be doing any work over here is this force H, right, which is pointing in the horizontal direction. Okay, so we don't know what is the nature of the edge. Is it a conservative or non-conservative force? So we will apply our general work energy expression, which is that W is equal to delta T, right? So the work done over here is integral H dot dr, right? So H is pointing in the X direction, dr is pointing in the X direction. So this is easy to determine. This is changing from 0 to L. So that's basically H times L. And that's the work done due to the force H. and that is equal to change in kinetic energy. So final kinetic energy minus initial kinetic energy is zero because you're going from rest. Final is 1/2 m wheel times vg square, where vg is the velocity of the center of mass of the wheel, plus 1/2 ig omega square. We have just seen that omega is equal to vg over r, so this would be 1/2 mw and vf square plus 1/2 ig vf over the radius squared. And that's basically the work done by the force H on the wheel. Now you can clearly see that in this expression there is no friction force, so which means that we really cannot compute the friction force from this analysis. Okay, let's do another interesting example. This is example 8.4. So again, we have a rear wheel drive roadster. This is 2600 pound rear wheel drive roadster shown in the figure, accelerates from 0 to 60 miles per hour in 7 seconds. So velocity changes from 0 to 60 miles per hour in 7 seconds. Each of the four wheels has a diameter D. So these are the things given to you. So let's write that. Given is this, the diameter of the wheels, the weight of the wheels, let's call them M sub W. And it has mass moment of inertia IG. We know their mass moment of inertia. We also have the mass of the car, so let's call that M. Assuming that the car accelerates uniformly, that we neglect rolling resistance, bearing friction and air drag, and that the wheels do not slip related to the ground, estimate the average engine power output as well as the torque provided to the rear wheels. So there are two things we have to find. We have to find the engine power output as well as the torque provided to the rear wheels. Okay, so this is clearly a finite displacement problem. We'll start by showing our quadrant system. And we will try to determine the torque as well as the power output. Okay, so kinematic analysis is fairly simple. Velocity of the center of mass of these wheels. So let's say this point is A, this point is B, this point is right over here is D. So velocity of the D, and let's say the center of front wheel is E, is equal to the D by 2, which is the radius of the wheel, times the angular velocity, right? So if we know the VD, we know what omega. Since we know the initial and final velocities, we can really find what the angular velocity is. Okay, now let's start by drawing the free body diagram and show what the forces are. So we have the weight of the car, we have the weight of the wheels, we have the normal reaction NA, we have the normal reaction NB, we have the friction force on the rear wheels because this is a rear wheel drive car. And then we have the friction force in the opposite direction on the front wheels because the front wheels are passive. There is no torque applied on them. So the friction forces oppose that motion. Okay. So these are all the forces that are acting on the car, right? So this is the free body diagram of the car as a whole when you separate it from the ground. Now the question is, what forces are doing any work over here? We have already seen that these friction forces, because of the no slip condition, don't do any work. Normal reactions over here will not do any work either because they are in the direction perpendicular displacement. MWG of the weights of the wheel also will not do any work because they're in the direction perpendicular displacement. And same is the case with this MG. So if you look at this free body diagram and look at all the forces, it looks like none of the forces are doing any work. Well, that can be true because the car is definitely accelerating, which means something is doing work on it that's causing the change in kinetic energy. So the question is, where is that work coming from? And if you say that the work is coming from the engine, then you're right. But we have to be able to account for that somehow in the free body diagram. So the key point to notice over here is, and remember, is that the internal forces and internal couples and moments can do work. Okay. So in general, it is not necessary that the internal forces, work done by internal forces or couples, will cancel out. So let's draw the free body diagram of the rear wheel alone first. So that's your rear wheel. We have the friction force FA, normal reaction, that's point A. We have the weight of the wheel. Then we'll have the reaction from the frame of the car transferred to the wheel through the axle. And the rear wheel is driven, so there is an external moment applied on the wheel from the... Now let's identify which of these forces and moments will do any work. We've already seen that NA will not do work, FA will not do any work, V will not do any work, this will not do any work, H will do some work, and M0 will do work on the rear wheel, right? Okay. Now if you draw the free body diagram of the rest of the car minus the rear wheel, what do you see? So if you draw the free body now of the rest of the car, and I will keep my front wheel, and I'm going to now get rid of my rear wheel. Okay, so here is the rear wheel. I'm drawing a dotted line because it doesn't exist, right? We have removed it. So if you remove it, what are the forces acting on the car? So we have the gravity, weight of it. We have the normal reaction on the front wheel. We have the friction force because this is unpowered wheel. And then from Newton's third law, so both V and H that are shown this way would be V this way and H that way. And then the moment on the car from the wheel would be M0, right? So the engine is applying this torque on the rear wheel. The same torque is being applied by the rear wheel on the engine. That's from Newton's third law. So these are all the forces that are actually acting on the frame of the car plus the front wheel. Okay, so now let's try to ask this question. Which of these forces are doing any work over here? Is MG doing any work? No. NB is not doing any work. FP is not doing any work. V is not doing any work over here. H will do work because the car is moving in the forward direction. What about M0? Will M0 do any work? That's the main question over here. M0 is the torque applied on the car, but the car is not rotating, right? Which means that M0 on the car will not do any work, which is not the case with the M0 over here on the rear wheel, because the rear wheel is actually allowed to rotate. So because of the relative rotation between the rear wheel and the rest of the car, the moment, the torque from the engine will do work on the rear wheel, but the same torque will not do any work on the car, right? So this is one scenario where you can clearly see that the internal force and the internal moments, their work may not necessarily cancel out. Now, as far as H is concerned, the work done by H on the car and on the wheel will actually cancel out. Why is that? Because let's say this H over here, which is pointing the direction of motion, is H times, the work done by H is H times delta X. If the car moves by delta X amount, then the work done by this H, which is pointing in the opposite direction, is minus H times delta X, which is the same distance, and these two cancel out, right? So the only work done over here is really on the whole car, is really just by this moment. None of the other forces or the couples, well, there are no other couples, are doing any work whatsoever on this car. So that makes our problem somewhat simpler, because we can now start with work done by the moment equal to change in kinetic energy. We already know how the kinetic energy changes, right? This is equal to T2 minus T1. T1 is zero because initially it is at rest, and T2 is equal to 1/2 MV final square, okay, plus 1/2 IG omega square. Okay, so what we can do is we can write this mass over here, the mass of the car, the frame minus the four wheels, and then we can write the kinetic energy of the four wheels, but then the translation part is same. So I can say M is equal to M of the frame plus four times mass of the wheel, okay? And then this would be simply just the rotational part of kinetic energy of the wheel multiplied by four, right? And we already know omega is equal to Vf over R. So we know the final velocity, we know the radius. So essentially the T2 is completely known. So that gives us the work done equal to delta T. But this work is being done by the moment, which is integral m d theta, right? And m is the moment that we're looking for. That's the moment we're looking for. So we're writing it m0. So this is equal to m0 delta theta. Now what is delta theta? Delta theta is the total rotation of the wheel when the car goes from 0 to 60 miles per hour in 7 seconds. So now the question is, can we compute how many times the wheel has rotated? Yes, we can, if we know how far the wheel has traveled, right? So let's say if it travels by distance L, then this should be equal to the radius of the wheel times delta theta. And this would compute the delta theta in radians. So now we need to compute what L is, right? So we know that this car is moving with uniform acceleration, which means we can apply our Galileo's equation, right? So we know V final is equal to V initial, which is zero, plus acceleration times delta T. So that's acceleration times 7 seconds. So that gives us acceleration as Vf over 7. And this should be written in meters per second or feet per second, whatever the units may be. So once we have the A0, we can compute the distance traveled, which will be V0 T plus 1/2 A0 delta T square, right? So from this is zero, we can compute what L would be. And once we have the L, we substitute that L over here, and that gives us delta theta, right? So then And here, delta theta would be known. We already know the total work done from change in kinetic energy. So that will give us the M0. So M0 would be equal to delta T over delta theta, right? So that gives you the torque, basically, in this case. Then the question is, what is the power? Well, power is defined as the rate at which the work is done, or dW over dt. So the work done is something we have just obtained. That's delta T. You divide it by the total time, which is delta T 7 seconds. And that will give you the power, which you can compute in watts, or you can compute in horsepower.